And I think I'm going under, part the waters, Lord. When I feel the waves around me calm the sea. When I cry for help, oh, hear me, Lord, and hold out your hand. Touch my life, still the raging storm in me.
Welcome to Soul Cafe Radio, where we cater food for the mind and soul. Please join us this hour for uplifting music, messages, and more. And now to the RMG Studios in Miami Gardens, Florida, and your host, the Word Master.
Hello, friends. Right off the bat, let me just say that today the study is going to be one of my favorites. I love this particular section in Galatians 5. Yesterday, if you were listening, right at the end, I said we're going to be looking at Galatians 5 and the armor of God. Boy, was I jumping the gun, or was I backtracking at least. I had already done the study on Ephesians, but the gospel armor was heavy on my mind, so that's why I said it. Today we're actually looking at the fruit of the Spirit, which is love. And before I say anything else, I just want to also say thank you for listening. Thank you for joining us today. And if something is being said that strikes a chord with you, please, won't you take a moment to hit that share button and let someone experience what you're experiencing. I want to thank each and every one of you who have been downloading the podcast. We are almost there to 4,000 total lifetime downloads. And with your help, we could make it over that number and push it way further. So please get on the platform and download the podcast for me, if you don't mind. At this time, would you bow with me as we invite God's presence to be with us? Let us pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies towards us. Father, today, many of us may have had a rough day. Things may not have gone all that we would have liked it to be. But as we settle in to hear your word, O God, I pray that your people truly would be edified, would, Lord God, be lifted up, and that their souls indeed would be watered, and that they would be fed. O Lord God, speak to your servant. Lord, bless everything that happens in this hour, and may your word, O God, come through with so much clarity tonight, O Lord God. Thank you for the opportunity to share with your people, and now may we all receive a blessing from what shall transpire this day, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, all week we've been having a special guest in our second segment, Paul, and, well, I said all week, it's just Tuesday. It's been one of those days. But he's back again, and he's just going to give us part two of what we've been looking at in his experience as a school teacher. So, following the item of music, we'll hear from Paul and his lessons from being a school teacher. Before we get there, however, our scripture reading for today is Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23. The Bible says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law."
This is Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Of rarest blue,
He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungry spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. To be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than this world affords today.
So, I want to come back, Paul. On yesterday, he talked about his perspective, lessons he's learned about the student population of today, with some keen insights about their conduct and their mindset. Today, we want to ask, what lessons have you learned about being a teacher yourself in the system of today, compared to teachers of yesterday, compared to teachers that you may have been inspired by? How do you see yourself viewed in the grand scheme of teaching history?
Lessons that I've learned as a school teacher is that I've learned that, you know, to be patient with my students, I've learned to be patient and to always place myself in their shoes, because honestly, I don't know what they've gone through. I don't know what's in their minds, you know? Because some of my students suffer schizophrenia, some severe depression, you know, or the lack of love from parents at home, or they're suffering, you know, they're going through some struggles, you know, as far as financially, you know, and like I said, you know, these kids, you know, they've been exposed to these particular realities. They come to school and they do a lot of comparison and contrast, and, you know, they're afraid of being judged based upon, you know, their background, financial background, you know, because not all of them come from loving homes, not all of them have houses to live in. So what I do is I place myself in their shoes and I try to approach them in a more loving way, you know, versus coming to them in a more authoritative way. I'm still authoritative towards them, but just, you know, but at the same time, I'm trying to be more in a loving way to see if I can, you know, soften their hearts or, and, you know, make a positive impact in their lives to the point where I can, you know, triumph in their lives as far as doing successfully well in their academics and their conduct. I mean, so far, I'm seeing some positive hope, you know, some positive results in that slowly but surely, you know, and it's because that I have been making a lot of phone calls at home, but at the same time, I'm trying to see, you know, just reach out to them the best way I can, see how I can, make things work between me and them, you know?
Gotcha.
So, but I'm not trying to be their friend. I'm their teacher.
Right.
But I'm trying to work with them as well, you know, and develop that sense of rapport.
That makes sense. Now, last question. At the end of the day, so to speak, sometime in the future, how would you like your students, or at least a particular student, reflecting back on yesteryear, remember Mr. Baptiste, my grade school teacher? What would you like them to remember about you? What is one value that you're willing to instill now that your students will remember in years to come?
My engagement to their well-being. I'm still relatively new as a teacher, but at the same time, I'm trying to, you know, communicate with them, you know, as far as in a loving way, you know, as far as, like, because children need love from grown-ups, you know. The love that I provide is based upon the love of God. which not all of them have been exposed to.
True.
You know, they've only had to react to it. They were never taught how to react to something like that, you know? So I want my students to remember me as a teacher who truly cared, who earnestly made efforts to, you know, help them with their academics, to be more engaged and more involved in their lives, and, you know, that a person who was more lenient to them, you know?
All right, thank you. See you tomorrow.
Sure thing.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. When we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His word quickly drives it away. Not a doubt or a fear, not a sigh or a tear, can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all of His order we
Soul Cafe Radio. Food for the mind and soul.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
Let your peace rule in my heart.
heart today with thanksgiving and long-suffering, bearing with all things in love, putting on the Your word dwell richly in my heart, teaching others in all heavenly songs, singing with all thankfulness, doing all in Your name. And when Christ
Galatians chapter 5 begins with this most important thought. It says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage." You see, friends, as you will see in the description to this podcast, if you are listening from the speaker app, it's those, I keep on forgetting whether it's vertical or horizontal, but it's those, I think, horizontal dots. Click on them and you'll get the description and you'll see the intro to the book of Galatians. But, brethren, the Galatians are a case study and they have their parallels, don't get me wrong, but they are a case study in how not to be a Christian. But thank God they had the Apostle Paul to steer them aright. And he says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ had made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage." So he's just tying in his two thoughts. And if you get a chance and you have not listened to our previous program, please go back and listen to part one on Galatians 4 and see why he mentions bondage in verse 1. But we're actually going to pick up in verse 16 and see what happens when a person is actually living in freedom as opposed to living in bondage. The Bible says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that you would." So in other words, what verse 16 is saying, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." So Paul then in verse 17 says that if that is true, then the opposite has to be true as well. If you're walking in the flesh, then you cannot fulfill the things of the Spirit. In other words, that which you want to do, say if you're living in the flesh and you want to do right, you can't. But if you're living in the Spirit, and the temptation comes to you to do wrong, it's virtually impossible, friends. The only way that you can is if you step out of being in the Spirit. See how that works? Verse 18 goes on to say, but if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things are not, shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So you see here in verse 18 when it says, but if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. And then it goes on from 19 to 21 to tell us the things that are contained in the letter of the law. Remember yesterday, or for those of you who are not listening chronologically, in our previous edition to the series, our first edition to the series, we saw how many people, even though they claim to be antinomian, or in other words, against the law, they actually are law keepers. They're seeking to do the letter of the law rather than the spirit of the law. But here in Galatians 5, we see a people who are entrenched under the condemnation of the law. That's what it means in verse 18. But if ye be led of the Spirit, you are not under the condemnation of the law. And he goes on to list a whole litany of things that are under the law, or under the condemnation of the law, put it that way. But then he goes on and picks up actually where we need to begin. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, Against such there is no law. I don't quite remember the year, but I do remember it was early on in my Christian experience. It might even have been sometime in the early 90s. That's way, way back for my memory to recollect. But at church, I remember the first person who blew my mind with this thought. He said, notice the reading, and it takes a special kind of person to tell a person who is a voracious reader to notice. The reading says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. It doesn't say the fruits, S, R, love, joy, peace. It says, is love. You see, friends, he said it, and ever since he said it, I never stopped believing it. There's only one fruit, beloved, there's only one fruit. Joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance are outgrowths of that one fruit, which is love. As I was sharing on this morning, it would be Friday, long day, like I said, Tuesday, November 23rd. This morning on our morning devotion, I was sharing how I had come to have a new, fresh appreciation for love. And why? Because, as the Bible shows, love covers everything. The Bible, Paul's own writings, actually has the three of the things that struck me. He said, love covers a multitude of sins. So when a person asks for forgiveness and you forgive, that's amazing love. When you show love as it's supposed to be in a sincere form, you're actually fulfilling the law. And by so doing, you won't do anything that's contrary to the law. He says also that three things remain: faith, hope, and love. And he says, but the greatest of these is love. Again, friends, I am getting a new and a greater appreciation for love. and of course primarily the love of God. But friends, I want you to notice though how our reading ends in verse 23. It says, against such there is no law. You ever had a craving for something that you knew that you had to have a limit to? What if there was something that you could eat or drink and there was no ramifications, there was no, oh, you can't have more than the allotted amount of this or that? In other words, the law of diet or the law of nutrition or the law of whatever that limits you. The Bible says concerning the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, which is joy, which is peace, long-suffering or patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance, there's no law. So, in other words, you could love at 50 miles, that's under the speed limit, you could love at 100 miles an hour down the highway, and the cops won't stop you. You could literally cheat yourself to an overabundance of joy, and you're not committing a crime or a sin. Friends, when I read those words with understanding, it gave a whole new meaning to the fruit of the Spirit passage. I had read it so many times, but when those last words hit my mind, it hit it like a ton of bricks. And it made all the difference in the world. Because you see, friends, love is not illegal. Love is not illegal. One more time. Love is not illegal. You can love all you want to and won't get in trouble for it. But here's the thing. The minute that you hate, not only are you going outside of the boundaries of God, but to the state, especially in the United States, where you have hate speech laws, bigotry laws, and so on and so forth. Hate is a big thing in our judicial legal system. But love, no one has ever adjudicated love to where it has become outlawed in any province, in any part of this world. Put it this way, the biggest despot on the planet, no matter if he passes 100 laws that restrict freedom of this or freedom of that, at his or her very being, they want to be loved. They need you to love them at some level. Love is one thing whether you are the president or whether you are a pauper, whether you are king or whether you are a killer. Love is one thing that you cannot live without. Friends, do you see the importance of love to this passage? If you walk in the Spirit, friends, if you walk in the Spirit, the Bible says, you will not fulfill, or it says, verse 16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Brethren, the Spirit of God is the love of God, flowing in all our hearts. And if you allow him, all these other outgrowths of the Spirit will come into play. So, contrary to the fruit of the Spirit, the works of the flesh, as the Bible says in, I believe we'll get there on tomorrow's program, where the Bible says that Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. If you sow to the Spirit, you shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. But if you sow to the flesh, you will reap corruption. So, the works of the flesh here, dear listener, only bring corruption, breed corruption. The ends thereof, as the Bible says, are the ways of death. But the fruit of the Spirit, brethren, is life. That's why the apostle lets us know that if you relish in the works of the flesh, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. And he closes it out in verse 25 by saying, 24 and 25, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If you live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. You see, friends, comparing Galatians 4 with Galatians 5, when we're looking at the covenants and the bondage and the living in the flesh as opposed to living in the Spirit, it seems strange to compare these two chapters, but friends, it is the same, because even though Abraham operated according to the flesh for a, we want to say, good reason, he was still being led of the flesh. He was still letting the flesh dominate when, according to 1 Corinthians 9:24 to 27, it is the mind that ought to dominate and the flesh held under, as it says in Philippians chapter 3. Brethren, understand that whether you, as the Bible says, all your righteousness is filthy rags, or whether all your filthy rags are filthy rags, whether you are working out the flesh to presumably do a righteous act, or whether you are working out in the flesh to accomplish selfishness, the end result is the same. It only works out in death. If you think I'm joking, ask David when he went into Bathsheba and expected the child that was produced from that illicit affair to live. Ask so many others when they tasted of the fruit of this world. Ask Moses as he realized that he could no longer partake of the delicacies of this life, that he could no longer relish the pleasures of sin for the season. You see, friends, if you sow to the flesh, the Bible is clear, you will die. But if you continue to feast on the fruit of the Spirit, you will live. And yes, friends, it is love. It is love. So we want to ask a question. How do we walk in the Spirit? The answer is clear. The Bible says in verse 24, they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. That's our friends. If there's no affection, if there's no pull of the flesh, then friends, you're operating in the Spirit. You're walking in the Spirit. Yes, friends, the temptations will and still would be there to the very end of time. But as you continue to advance, to grow to the stage of Christian maturity that the Bible says that we all need to measure up to, then, my friends, you will be walking in the Spirit and you will not give heed to the flesh. If we live in the Spirit, let us walk in the Spirit. And remember, that is our sub-theme for this mini-series on lessons from the book of Galatians. I trust, brethren, that it is your desire to be Spirit-led. And again, as we highlighted It is by allowing God's love to be all over and through you. Yes, friends, when God's love is in residence there, there will be joy. And no matter what happens, the world will see you bubbling over. There will be peace. And so whatever storm seems to threaten this old ship of Zion, no matter what happens, you will hear the Savior say, "Peace, be still." There'll be patience. No matter how long it's taken for Christ to come, because you're living His life now, you're living His life now, you're experiencing Him. As He says, "Tarry until I come," you can tarry. Gentleness, something that is also lacking in this day and age. The Bible called it, it says, "Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall grow cold. Very few are gentle, much more being good." Faith, the Bible says that, again, Christ Himself speaking, He said that when He comes, will He find faith on the earth? But the fruit of the Spirit is goodness, gentleness, and faith. Meekness, humility, temperance, moderation. The Bible says that this is how we are to be Spirit-led. And all of this is an outworking of love. The Bible is clear, brethren. If you love me, Jesus says, you'll keep my commandments. Jesus is clear. If you have love, then friends, your joy will be from love. Your peace will be from love. Your long-suffering will be from love. Your gentleness will be from love. Your goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance will all be an outworking of the love that's being worked inside of you. I want to pause and play a song, and then when we come back, we'll have our closing thought, and we'll wrap up from here.
This is Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed before His own. But I know
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
I can't take a heart that's broken, make it over again, but I know a man who can. I can't take a soul that's sin sick, wash it white as the snow, but I know a man who can. And some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men, but I call him Jesus. But I know a man who can. I can't cause blind eyes to open or make the lame to walk again. Oh, but I know a man who can. Some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men, but I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend. If you feel like no one loves you and your life is out of hand, well, I know a man who can. Yes, I know a man who can.
I so badly wanted to say what she just said, but I would be doing it injustice, and so I want you to take her words as the takeaway. I know a man who can. And today, as we wind down, I'm telling you, yes, friends, let love lead the way indeed. And as you are love-led, you'll be spirit-led. And as you are spirit-led, love, joy, peace, patience, all of these things will be part of your character, and the works of the flesh will be non-existent. Sure, the pull will be there, the desire will be there, but guess what? The more you consent to be governed by the Spirit, the more power you will have to resist. The more you say no, the stronger your resolve will be for next time. I pray by the grace of God that as it says in verse 24 and 25, they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with their affections and lusts. That's the only way to kill it, my friends. That's the only way to put it out of its miseries, by not loving the things that the flesh loves, and by feeding the spirit and starving the flesh into oblivion. I pray by the grace of God, beloved, that you would be such a person who is desirous of allowing Jesus Christ to make you into all that you were meant to be. Just before we go into prayer, I have a very important announcement. On Thursday, morning, while many of you are preparing your Thanksgiving, I'll be on air live with Soul Cafe Radio from about 1 a.m. Eastern Time to about 6 a.m. Eastern Time. And I'll be back from, I believe, 12 until 5 or 6. I'll have the information that you'll need in the description for tomorrow's podcast. So stay tuned. And wherever you are listening, wherever you got the link from, it'll be posted there. So I'll be on twice with 2 5-hour programs. One as you're getting ready and the other one as you're going through your day. And remember, on that second one, I'm requesting you to send in your song request that you want to hear played during those 5 hours. And if you want to say publicly thank you to someone for being a blessing to you this year, then please get in contact with me and you could have that person get a shout out on the air. Additionally, if you would like to record a thank you or a testimony, then you're welcome to do so, whether the platforms are WhatsApp or Facebook or however you can reach me with a voice note. And I really would appreciate that. And I'll be contacting some of you with another recording that I would like to get done. Some of you will be hearing from me not too long after this. Friends, I thank you once again for joining me live today here on Soul Cafe Radio. And I trust that those of you who are listening to the podcast version will also be willing to share the link as you listen. May God bless you abundantly. Remember, friends, that this program solely exists because of the grace of God and your continued financial assistance and prayers. Please continue to do both. And remember, your prayers is paramount. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for being with us today. And I pray, Lord God, that as we separate one from the other, that we may never separate from you, O God. Lord, we have become a society that has been entrenched in total worldliness. Lord, this world has nothing for the believer. It's all lost, O God. Everything is becoming so evil, Lord God. But as your people seek to rise higher, O Lord God, we want to do so, knowing full well that if God be for us, who can be against us? We want to thank you, Lord God. We want to thank you so much for your blessings. Father, please, I pray for any person who right now sees that they need to give their lives over to the Lord so that they could indeed walk in the Spirit. Father, I pray, O Lord God, I pray sincerely that if anyone has been operating in the flesh, thinking it's been operating in the Spirit, like I said on yesterday, I pray, Lord God, that you show them the way. Please, Heavenly Father, please, before it's too late. Thank you for the opportunity again, Lord, to share, and I pray that someone would have benefited today, whether in the word or in song. And I thank you for blessing this program with your manifested presence. Thank you, Lord God. May you continue to oversee the operation of this ministry to your grace and glory. I do pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is Soul Cafe Radio. Food for the mind and soul.
Father, cleanse these filthy hands. I long for brokenness, for all my sin and shame. Tears you've wept on numberless sands. With every sin I know, I break your heart again. Help me to understand your pain. I conform to this world and blaspheme your holy name. Help me to understand your word. If I'm a friend of this world, it's hatred towards my God. Fire of God, burn in me, consume all my wickedness, so I will not love this world, so I will not be a friend of this world any longer, so I will not be a friend of this world any longer. Father, break my prideful heart. I come before you humbly so I can stand and wash my dirty feet. I've wandered from your path and walked on in holy land. Help me to understand your pain. When I conform to this world and blaspheme your holy name, help me to understand your word. If I'm a friend of this world, it's hatred towards my God. Fire of God, burn in me, consume all my wickedness, so I will not love this world, so I will not be a friend of this world. Fire of God, burn in me, consume all my wickedness, so I will not love this world, so I will not be a friend of this world any longer, so I will not be a friend of this world. Fire of God, burn in me, consume all my wickedness, so I will not love this world, so I will not be a friend of this world any longer, so I will not be a friend of this world.
Thank you for joining us today on Soul Cafe Radio. You've been listening to powerful music and messages for the mind and soul. Join us next time when we deliver more of the same. And remember to visit our website at www.soulcafeonline.org.